first summer school that actually we celebrated in the year 98. It was the first summer school in mathematical physics and analysis in Cuernavaca, and Alejandro was one of the participants. And he also participated in a school in Malta, celebrated in Cuernavaca as well. And in particular, Alejandro has been always willing to support the activities of Mexico, so I take the chance of the opportunity to thank Alejandro for that. And Alejandro has a very important and interesting and nice work in some classical analysis in particular. And in particular, he's one of the responsible people to prove a so-called Wiedemann trace formula, really the first proof in rules of mathematical theory. So today, Alejandro is going to speak about the propagation of coherent states in the classical trace formula and the proper center capacity. Please, Alejandro.
Well, I want to thank you and the organizers for the invitation to speak. It's always a real pleasure to be here. Thanks to the members for me. So my talk is really about mostly about all things.
Gracias. So my talk is going to be mostly about all things, and in fact, I've been I was thinking about the same first summer school in analysis that Carlos made reference to, and you can see a lot of what I will talk about, especially the trace formula, already there. So as a reference, I can point to the proceedings of the first summer school in here in Cuernavaca, which was it was 1998, and it was a nice, very nice event, and it was also the first joint publication of the American Math Society with the Mexican Math Society. And I prepare a very general talk, mostly, because I suspect that not many people are familiar with what this semi-classical analysis is, and it's nice to give a seminar type talk anyway. So what I have been interested in for a long time is the relationship between the mathematics of classical and quantum mechanics. I find the relationship between them fascinating. As you will see in a moment, the mathematics of classical and quantum are very different, and yet there is a relationship between them that shows up in settings that are very general, that don't necessarily have to do with physics at all. So I am a pure mathematician. I'm not a physicist. So let's start with with classical mechanics, on Rn, and so what is that? Well, so one has one starts with I want to talk about the Hamiltonian formulations. One starts with a so-called Hamiltonian function, and which is really a function on the cotangent bundle of Rn, which in this case is just Rn identified with Rn cross Rn. And in the classical case, so then the variables here will be x and p. And the classical case is when h of x and p is 1/2 mod p squared plus some potential function v. V is called a potential function. And then one forms the Hamilton's equations which is a system of ordinary differential equations that are x dot equals partial h partial p and p dot equals minus partial h partial x, which is the equations for the flow of a vector field c, which is just partial h partial p partial partial x minus partial h partial x partial partial p. And the structure of this field is that it satisfies the following equation. Where is the eraser? It satisfies the following equation, where omega is a symplectic form, summation dpi wedge dxi. And this structure here generalizes to Hamiltonian mechanics on symplectic manifolds. And I will talk about this in the second part of the talk. The properties of omega that make it special is that it's closed and non-degenerate. So that's the definition of a symplectic manifold right there. It's a pair of a manifold with such a form, closed and non-degenerate form. And it's an easy thing to check that this system is equivalent to Newton's second law in the classical case. And this is the setting for Hamiltonian mechanics. And as you solve these equations, or the solution of these equations, give you a flow. The solutions constitute the Hamilton flow from the cotangent bundle of Rn into itself, which preserves the symplectic form. It's an automorphism of the structure. Now, on the quantum mechanical side, things are extremely different. One doesn't start with a phase space or a symplectic manifold. One starts with a Hilbert space. So instead of x omega, and in the usual setting, which I will not talk about very much actually, is when the Hilbert space is L2 of Rn in the x variables. And instead of h, one has the Schrödinger operator. One has the operator, maybe I'll call it S for Schrödinger. It's an operator acting in this space, which is now minus. Now I introduce this parameter, which in physics is a constant. It's called Planck's constant, but for us it's a parameter. And then the Laplacian. I take the positive Laplacian, so I write it like this. Plus multiplication by V. And instead of Hamilton, one has the time-dependent equation. Instead of Hamilton's equations, one has the Schrödinger equation, which is, maybe I write it here. So it looks completely different. It's a completely different theory. So the equation for the time-dependent Schrödinger equation is this with an initial condition. And when the potential has good properties and so on, this defines instead of phi t, instead of having phi t like this, one gets a solution. So the solution can be written as psi equal to some unitary operator acting on the initial condition, and ut is now a unitary group. So it's as you see, I keep saying, it's an entirely different type of mathematical structure. And the question is, you know, one knows that these two, from the point of view of physics, one knows that these two are very successful theories, and they have, somehow they have to match. And that this the match is best seen, I guess, when you take the semi-classical limit, which is when this parameter is allowed to tend to zero. So that's going to be the. I want to talk about some theorems that actually exemplify that this is a subject that supports, I think, interesting theorems. And so I will talk about, I can tell you about two theorems that I'm going to talk about. They're in the title, The Propagation of Coherent States, and then the so-called trace formula. Those will be my two theorems exemplifying this. And then I want, but the I think what some interesting and more recent observations have to do with possible connections with symplectic topology. And I don't have a theorem to show you yet. I have, I think, an interesting observation. And by the way, this subject was the topic of a recent conference in Tel Aviv, where, you know, people are trying to think about the relationship between symplectic topology and quantum mechanics, which is, I think, an exciting idea. So I want to say then first, as a first example of this, I want to talk about coherent states, but I want to change my Hilbert space first, because the connection with symplectic topology is not about L2, or it doesn't go through L2 of position configuration space, but it goes instead using a Barman space. So this Hilbert space, the Hilbert space turns out to be, for physical reasons, doesn't actually have to matter very, doesn't matter very much. You can use various types of Hilbert spaces. And for Barman space, what one does is one identifies the cotangent bundle of this, of instead of the cotangent bundle, well, what one really does is one puts a complex structure. One puts a complex structure on it. So in the Euclidean case, you just get Cn, and you introduce a complex variable. Zj is, well, there are some normalizations that people tend to use. Okay. And then the symplectic form, omega, is something like, I should have said that since this is an overview, kind of a general talk, I will probably get some constants wrong, but they don't matter, right? It's a big, I'm trying to convey some bigger picture and not details.
Are J beta imaginary unit?
Yes. It's also a constant. One of the constants that I leave out. Sorry about that. And so anyway, so then here you see what you get is, it's a form of type 1-1. The symplectic form is a form of type 1-1. Up to some, I think that's probably okay. And now what we have really is, if I call this thing X, I have then not only an X and an omega, but I also have a complex structure J here that I introduced thanks to your help putting the I where it should be. So what I actually get here is a Kähler manifold. And then what one does is when one looks at this Barman space, the definition of Barman space is the following. So now one looks at entire functions, so of n complex variables. So d bar f equals zero. And there is an interesting norm, which is the following. So you integrate, I mean, you can't just integrate the mod square of the function because that's always going to be infinite. But instead, what you put here is this Barman weight, mod z square over h bar, and then the xdp. And you demand that that be finite. And so I want to call your attention to this Barman weight, because I want to show you talk about the geometry behind that, which then can be generalized a lot. The geometry behind this is that one should really think of B. One should think of B as L2 sections of a holomorphic line bundle, which in case is trivial. I mean, these are just functions. However, it has a non-trivial Hermitian structure. So you just have over each point of Cn, you have a line, but the Hermitian structure on each fiber is non-trivial, meaning that this is going to be precisely that weight. Put a square there. So that this norm is really the norm of a function as a section of this line bundle with that Hilbert, with that Hermitian structure. And what one has is that the connection between that Hermitian structure and the symplectic form is that W is, now there's another constant, probably something like this, V bar D log of this function. Which means that omega is the curvature up to a constant. So we end up having then a geometric structure that consists of a Kähler manifold and a line bundle, Hermitian line bundle, with the right curvature. And that now I can just say, consider, we'll consider all of these things instead of just Cn. So anyway, let's go back to Cn because that can, you know, because to be concrete, I want to give examples. So I talked about coherent states. So what are coherent states? Coherent states are in Barman, coherent states in Barman are the closest approximation to delta functions. So what do I mean by that? Well, it's a little bit complicated to explain so let me tell you the standard ones. Let me tell you a little bit something else. I can take all L2 of Cn with this weight, let's call this d lambda. So these are not holomorphic sections, but you can. There is an orthogonal projection, and you can take a point W in Cn and project. Turns out that one can apply the projection to a delta function. And what you get is remarkably an element in B, and namely, what you get for these coherent states are these functions E C W bar over H. It's a formula. There are some formulas that I, you know, this very concrete. And remarkably, as I said, this is an element in the Hilbert space. So these Barman spaces are beautiful. You have these coherent states. And one way to think about them, so this is Cn. One way to think about, visualize how these guys are sort of like delta functions, is that if you look at their Barman norm, so you look at their, not their norm, but the length in the Hermitian structure. So you look at this thing. This is called doesn't matter what it's called. It's called the Husimi function. So this function is the length of this coherent state.
Is there a C squared in the formula or
no? It's zero.
Mimic that.
No, boy. So it's a very nice calculation that I don't have time to do. To see where this function here, I put the z squared in front, the way I set things up. This is the formulation. And, excuse me?
The norm of e to the zeta is e to the real part of zeta. And then you just have
You have a quadratic function. So if you look at the, if you compute this function and see where it peaks, this function, the length of this as a section of the line bundle that I mentioned with this Hermitian structure, if you look at it as in the proper length, you will see that it is e to the minus a real quadratic form centered at W. So it essentially is the relevant thing is just going to be e minus zw mod squared over h bar. So when you look at the length of that. Does that make sense, Renato?
Yeah.
So you see.
Somewhere I wanted to look at that, but I don't know.
That's right. So the way I framed it, elements in environment space are holomorphic. And then, but you measure the length as sections of a line bundle using this Hermitian structure. So that's the thing to look at. Yeah, and in fact, this not only tells you that the coherent state is concentrating here, but it's concentrating. You get z minus w, right? Norm length squared. So it's concentrating in a disk, in a round disk. Somehow the metric, the flat metric, is showing up. Euclidean metric. There are more general coherent states that concentrate like this, but along on ellipses. They are sort of squeezed in one direction and elongated in another one. So there are more general ones that I need to state the first theorem. I think we're doing okay. More general coherent states have the following form. They are of the form like this, so they have a quadratic part. So they still have this part, but then they have a factor here. It's e to the, so it's z minus w alpha a transpose z minus w. So here's a quadratic form in z minus w. Quadratic form in z minus w over 2h bar, where alpha is an n by n complex matrix, and you have to ask that it has some properties, namely that the identity minus alpha conjugate alpha is positive definite. Okay, so this means that alpha is in some kind of upper half plane transformed by a Cayley transform. So there's this means this condition here will tell you that this thing is again in environment space. And now when you compute, it's kind of a messy calculation, but when you compute where this length, you get a quadratic form here, so you're gonna get concentration on ellipses instead of circles. So what is the theorem on propagation of coherent states? So the theorem is that let you from environment space to environment space be solve the Schrödinger, be the solution, the fundamental solution, or the group, unitary group. I didn't tell you something, which is, I'm sorry, there's too many things. If I skipped one step, I said that one can work with B instead of L2 of Rn, because there is so-called a Bartman transform, which is an explicit, I'm not going to give you the formula because it's not important, but there is an explicit unitary transform that does the right thing. Does the right thing so that the operator, on the Bartman space corresponding to the Schrödinger operator is just a conjugate. So I have to do A inverse Schrödinger A. So it's just a conjugate. You pass the Schrödinger operator up to here, and you get this operator, which is a kind of Toeplitz operator. It's approximated by a Toeplitz operator. So when every time I say approximated, it's going to be in the setting of letting h bar go to zero. So what is the Toeplitz operator? Well, I almost erased this projection, capital pi, from L2 to Bartman space. And the Toeplitz operator is, for example, an operator of the following form. So I have a Hamiltonian from Cn into R be the classical Hamiltonian. That perhaps the one I spoke about at the beginning, or something in more general class. And what this Toeplitz operator does is that you take a function psi, you take a function, the Toeplitz operator goes from B to B. What you do is you take a function f in Bartman space, and then you have a function in Bartman space, this analytic function, you have this classical Hamiltonian, you multiply them, and that's of course no longer in Bartman space, no longer holomorphic, but then you brutally apply the projection. And you can do this, these are the classical Toeplitz operators with multiplier, the function h. And it turns out that the Bartman transform, when you transform the Schrödinger, the whole picture to Bartman space, that's what you get. So now I can try to state the theorem, which is that let U of T, the unitary group, on Bartman space, solving the Schrödinger equation, so you solve the Schrödinger equation, you pass to Bartman space and you solve the Schrödinger equation there, and what one can do is question what happens when I apply this to a coherent state. So let's suppose that we apply it to one of the standard coherent states. Okay, so it's a very nice thing to imagine. You start with one of these standard coherent states centered at a point W, and you propagate it quantum mechanically. What do you get? Well, any guesses? What you get is another coherent state. But now it may have a quadratic part. You get a plus an error term. That's plus small in h bar, something that is small in h bar. So it's everything is as an asymptotic. And where WT is simply the Hamilton flow of H applied to the initial condition. So you simply are going to flow from W to W of T along the classical trajectory. So this is the classical trajectory. That's a point. And the coherent state, the evolved coherent state up to an error that tends to zero in H bar, looks like another coherent state, or is another coherent state, but it now may have been squeezed in one way or another. Okay? And one can compute, there's probably an amplitude as well. No, because it's unitary. I think we're okay. There might be a phase factor. I'm not sure. I think we can incorporate that here. Anyway, one has an equation for what this matrix that shows up here is. One can describe in terms of the classical flow. I'm not going to write it down. I am going to write it down. Something. There is some way of writing it. Some metaplectic stuff, right? There's an equation. I don't want to go into it. So that you can predict how this thing is going to squeeze. So I wanted to start with this. This is an old theorem. Actually, I haven't seen a proof of it, direct proof in Barryman space. But this has been known for a long time. And it's probably the easiest way to show you the classical trajectory show up in quantum mechanics, in this asymptotics as you take small in h bar. So it's a very graphic way of doing it. And in fact, this fact can be used. And I'm not going to say this in detail. This can be used to construct approximations to U of T. U of T is in principle very difficult to compute, but an important object. And people in physical chemistry are actually using propagated coherent states to compute approximations to this, but that's another subject. Now, the second theorem that I wanted to talk about was the trace formula, and that will have the connections to the Hofer-Zehnder capacity that I want to mention at the end. So the trace formula is not a priori about propagation at all, a priori. It looks about, starts by considering the time independent, the eigenvalue problem for the Schrödinger equation. So let's assume that we are in a position where we have a, so let's assume that there exists an orthonormal basis, Hj, orthonormal basis of the Hilbert space, say Barryman space, that are actually eigenfunctions. I should have mentioned the simplest example is the harmonic oscillator. Barryman introduced the Barryman space because of this example in dimension 1, where the Schrödinger operator is just h bar z d dz. You only have one complex variable. Okay, there is a 1/2 somewhere. 1/2 equals 1, it's a constant. Okay, I feel guilty now. And the eigenfunctions Ej are just the monomials, z to the j. Are the monomials, those are the psi j. Okay, there is a normalization formulas. Yeah. There's a normalization, because I said orthonormal. And the eigenvalues are just h bar j plus 1/2. So it's completely, it's very nice. If you write a harmonic oscillator in L2, you get a second order equation, because you have the Laplacian term. You pass to Waterman space, you get a first order equation. Okay, and the solution of this, the unitary ut that I mentioned here, is composition with rotations. So here, there's no, these coherent states are not at all deformed. They simply rotate. Everything rotates. It's all geometric stuff. Okay? However, let's look at what happens more generally. And so everything here, as you can see, everything depends on h bar. And so the trace formula links the distribution of the eigenvalues to periodic trajectories, periodic classical trajectories. Now, it's a little bit complicated to write down. So the theorem, and it has some, under some kind of generic assumptions. Yeah, so, sorry, I'm not sure who. So Ernesto asked about shape of a drum. Yeah, I should have said that another class of examples that I haven't mentioned is when you take M, a compact Riemannian manifold. And then you take your Schrodinger operator, you simply take the Laplacian, the Laplace-Beltrami operator, no potential term if you want to do entirely geometry. And then these EJs are just obviously just h squared times the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. Lambda j are the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. And so this kind of theorem that I'm about to write will relate, is actually the equivalent to the Doister-McGilliman Chassaranco-Landeverdier trace formula in this case. And it links the distribution of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian to closed to periodic classical trajectories. In this case, the classical trajectories are geodesics. So this trace, in this case, as I said, is equivalent to the Doister-McGilliman and others trace formula, and it relates the distribution of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian to the closed geodesics. And that can be used to address the question, can you hear the shape of a drum in various ways? But there are other ways of, can you hear the shape of a drum is a much more, it's a different kind of question. And there are many different techniques to approach that problem. So, theorem. So consider a Schrodinger operator with discrete spectrum. And I have H, my classical Hamiltonian. Okay, so what does the trace formula say? Well, it's a formula, so it has a left-hand side and a right-hand side. I mean, it's not really a formula, but well, it is a formula. It's a theorem that results in a certain relationship. So I'm just gonna write it down. The left-hand side is the following kind of thing. I want to write under generic assumptions. So, bear with me. So the kinds of things that one can treat with the trace formula are sums that involve the eigenvalues. And they involve the eigenvalues, and they involve a parameter E. And you make such a concoction. So it's a sum over the eigenvalues. So this is sum over eigenvalues. And E is a parameter. Okay, and phi is a test function. And there is a strong condition on the test function, which is that phi check, which is the inverse Fourier, I should have just said Fourier. It's another sign transform, has to be compactly supported and smooth. Okay, so that's the left-hand side. One way to think about it is that there is a way to think about it. So this is the real line, and here you fix this parameter E, and you have the EJs. You have the EJs that, you know, it's a spectrum. And so now you're looking at, because you're dividing by h bar and phi is rapidly decreasing, you're looking at something that is of the size of h bar. You're looking at a small window near this fixed variable E and averages of those numbers, the distances between E and EJ. And this has an expansion as h goes to zero. Okay, and it's a little bit complicated to tell you what this is, but I want to tell you two things. The main thing is that, so these periodic trajectories, you can think of this as, this is a trace of something. It's a sum of, this is how the eigenvalues of some function of the Hamiltonian. So this is of the Schrödinger operator. This is a trace of a function of the Schrödinger operator. And if you think of the unitary map evolution moving these coherent states around, you might think that when you take the trace is when the coherent state comes back to itself. And along, when you have a periodic trajectory, you have a coherent state going back to itself. So somehow, taking the trace on the classical side could means that you are more or less looking at periodic trajectories or intersections of the graph of the flow over a certain time period with the diagonal.
Let me ask you, if you aren't thinking of this in the right way, but this is a little bit like the partition function of if you want to write it in terms of Feynman integrals, say for the Brownian motion or things like that, for the Laplacian.
Maybe. I mean, for Brownian, this is nothing, this is all deterministic. I'm not sure what you mean by Brownian motion.
Well, I just mean the Laplacian.
Yeah. I mean, some sort of density of states, localized density of states, localized around this parameter E. Okay? So here's the right-hand side, and the thing, I only want to tell you that periodic trajectories show up. So there are two terms.
It could be sometimes, for example, under the very nice conditions, a topological invariant.
No, not that I know of. No, I want to get to some indication of a symplectic topology invariant in the next 5 minutes. Now, this is actually very, very, the spectra is a very delicate object that has a priori nothing to do with topology, especially since we're talking about operators that are acting on functions. It's very analytic at this point. Mm-hmm. So what about the right-hand side consists of? Yeah.
For example, in the trace formula proof of the TS in the series.
Yes. But so you're talking about taking the heat equation proof? Is that what you mean? Yeah. But there you're actually looking at a different type of, you're looking at the difference, right, between you get.
So this is not the
no. No, here in the T.S. Singer theorem, you manage to write down, you want to find the dimension of the kernel, you have positive spectrum and so on, and negative spectrum as well. You do. And so it's different, it's definitely very different. Yeah. Sorry. yeah. This is much more like the, in fact, an example of this is the Poisson summation formula. The Poisson summation formula, so if you do this for the Laplacian on the circle, you're going to get, the eigenvalues are basically the integers, or if you take, well, you have to look at ddx instead of the second derivative, which is more, but I say that it's morally, actually, it's very much equivalent to this, where you get, I'm going to get it wrong. Maybe it's, I don't know whether it's 2 pi n or 2 or n over, I think it's either 2 pi n or n over 2 pi, but it's, you have a, and there's a 2 pi here or something. Yeah. So you can think of you can think of this as length, as the length of the period of the circle going around and around, which is periodic, and then here you have the eigenvalues. So this is much more analogous to this.
Okay.
There's a Poisson summation form.
Or the Selberg transform.
Or the Selberg transform. Absolutely. Except, yeah, it's all of this other transform. Now the right-hand side consists of terms of two types. Okay, so one is what we call the Weyl term, which is, first of all, the thing explodes according to some power of h bar, and then you're going to get the volume of the energy surface. So there is this E parameter, you get a volume, and there's some 2 pi to some power. And then, but what I wanted to emphasize, that's a leading term, but you get a whole expansion in increasing powers of h. It's a power series expansion. So this term is the, is, I want to emphasize this is a power series. Okay, and you get that kind of term. And from here you get the Weyl estimate. I really don't, I'm running out of time. I don't want to write the Weyl estimate. And then you get the contributions from periodic trajectories. Oh, I forgot. The test function shows up in a stupid way, but I want to write it down, which is phi hat of zero. It's in front here. Okay? And then the periodic trajectory is gamma on the energy surface. Everything is localized on this energy surface, E. And the contribution of the periodic trajectories is very, very different. It doesn't consist of a power series, but it's highly oscillatory. And that makes it, from my point of view, interesting. The contribution is of the form, you have e to the I h inverse. So that's the oscillatory term. There's a coefficient here, which is the integral of the action, pdx. So this is the action of the trajectory. And then you have coefficients. So that is in front of, there is this phi hat, phi check of the period. So t gamma is a period. So that's why it looks like the Poisson summation formula. And then you have some coefficients here, c gamma j, and the power series expansion. And there's a formula for the principal term that is not interesting. But the point is that for this talk, but the point is that this is highly oscillatory. And so somehow, the what I want to emphasize somehow is that the periodic trajectories and their periods, so somehow the periodic trajectories or the periods of the periodic trajectories can be detected generically. From quantum mechanics, quantum mechanical calculations, I guess. So somehow this is what I want to emphasize, because of I want to move on to this more general setting of and talk about capacities. Does that? Yeah, I should say why I do want to say generically explain. So, for example, if you want to do something inverse spectral problem, you want to make sure, say for the Laplacian, just the Laplacian case, that you want to affirm that if you know the spectrum of the Laplacian, then you for sure know the length spectrum. Suppose you want to make that a theorem. Well, there is an obstacle that is extraordinarily annoying, and I don't know how to get around. Nobody knows how to get around it, as far as I know. Which is that you see these coefficients. I didn't write them down, but they're complex numbers, and you may be so unlucky as to have two different gammas of the same length, the same period, that somehow are such that their coefficients kill each other, annihilate each other. You see, because each, I should say, it's all additive, right? So you have the Weyl term plus contributions for each geodesic, for which this is not zero. So the sum, so each, I should emphasize this, so very important actually, that each gamma inside the energy surface, such that gamma is in the support of this thing, contributes. And it contributes additively. So it's very hard to I mean, what it could conceivably happen that you have two geometrically distinct gamma with the same period, and when you add the contributions, the contributions cancel each other out completely. So you don't see them. Right? So it's very annoying, but such is life. It is sometimes known that cannot happen.
It's like two more singularities that cancel each other.
Yes.
In terms of weakness.
I mean, it can happen, but in fact, if on the certain assumptions like in negative curvature, one knows that because one knows the coefficient, the leading term, and so one knows that in negative curvature that cannot happen. But anyway, so what about how long do I have? 5 minutes? Is that
dos
minutos? So now let I'll be quick. Now let x. Omega J and then L be a general Kähler manifold with I'll be very quick with L a Hermitian line bundle with curvature omega. So just as I said, this is the case in CN, but now I want to take X to be compact. So we can do the same quantum mechanical game, except that now H, you see, actually the Barman space dependent on H bar. So H bar will now be, it turns out, because if we assume X is compact, it has to be the reciprocal of an integer. And these are just the holomorphic sections. Of L tensor K. So now we have a trace formula. We can do the whole thing. I will not. I don't have time. But one can do the whole thing that I mentioned. There's a trace formula that I proved with Borthwick and Paul in this setting in the late 90s, and everything works fine. Now, what is this capacity? This Hofer-Zehnder capacity. Of, well, it's a number, it's just a number that one associates to the to X omega. It's simply one number, but it's a very powerful number. Its capacity, well, there's, you know, there are many others. And the way I want to write it, Hofer-Zehnder of X omega, is the following thing. So you look at, so it's going to be the supremum. It's the supremum of the minimal period, minimal positive period of a closed trajectory of, so it's a sup over h of h from x into r, but I have to normalize h. And then normally, so this is not the definition that you find in the books on the subject, but it is, I claim it's equivalent to it. Okay, so you, so let me just mention very quickly. So this is a normalization of H of a Hamiltonian. You can add a constant to a Hamiltonian and not change the dynamics. You can multiply a Hamiltonian by an overall constant and don't change much the dynamics. You just change the period. You rescale time. So somehow by rescaling time, you can focus your attention on Hamiltonians whose image is 0, 1. And you look at how small a period can that be they have. And then you take the sup of all those. And this is called a capacity. And the observation that I'm trying to work on and understand better is that this can be detected. This single number can be detected quantum mechanically. Why? Well, because just to finish, because you can detect the length spectrum from this, from the trace formula. And in fact, what it's telling you is that between the interval 0 and the Hofer-Zehnder capacity, this is somehow the, or maybe I should put minus Hofer-Zehnder capacity to the Hofer-Zehnder capacity. This is the interval over which you can look at test functions with support of phi check in here. And this is the largest interval for which you can hope to not get oscillations. So somehow, this is telling you how, and I cannot make this precise, I very much would like to, how a quantum spectrum can be distributed without creating oscillations in the trace formula. And it's given by this invariant, which is a symplectic invariant, and it can be used to prove non-embedding theorems or embedding theorems, non-embedding theorems. So it's just a very nice, for me, a very interesting line of thought that it's just being developed, and hopefully it'll lead to something. Anyway, I'm out of time. Thank you.
Well, how does the intuition look in a sphere and in a cylinder that both have the same capacity, or, I mean, with the simplest examples of
So the intuition is, yeah, the intuition is that, say, for a sphere, the intuition is that, so there, the you have the very, say, the height function, which is this very nice Hamiltonian, that if you think about That's an example where you can compute, for that Hamiltonian, you can compute everything. You know that it's periodic of a certain period. I mean, you have to normalize things. And then you can see that the spectrum, you can compute the spectrum, which is consists of eigenvalues that are evenly distributed. And you can see that this relationship holds exactly when you have, you know, when you have it's like the Poisson summation formula that you restrict to a finite set of integers, and the support of phi check is exactly this has the right size so that it doesn't start, or the right hand side of the Poisson formula doesn't start oscillating. That's really the only intuition I have. It's something like the oratoric variety in general. So actually, this leads me to conjecture, I don't know if this is known, that this capacity for oratoric variety is the diameter of the moment polytope. Because somehow this is how far can you go evenly distributing eigenvalues. But I actually don't know if it's true. I'm not an expert in symplectic topology. I'm an amateur.
But. So a famous example comes from Quillen's line bundle for moduli spaces of stable bundles. Is there a picture for the capacity in this case?
I don't know that. You mean in relation like with Chern-Simons?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I have no idea. It's a very good question, actually. I mean, I have done some work on Chern-Simons, but not in this direction. Yeah.
More questions, please? And if not, let's thank Alejandro for his time.
Thank you.
Good morning, Tom.